Katerina is starting her second career in education and passed her Praxis Special Education exam using our study guide. She says the prep materials provided were well aligned with the test. My name's Emma, and I've helped thousands of teachers pass their Praxis exams. And today, I'm here to help you. This video is going to prepare you for the Praxis Special Education Core Knowledge and Applications Test. This video is going to cover three things: what's on the test and how to study for it, the most likely concepts you'll need to know, and we're going to look at a few practice questions. Now, this Praxis Special Education exam consists of five content categories: development and characteristics of learners, planning and the learning environment, instruction, assessment, and foundations and professional responsibilities. Together, categories 2 and 3 make up about half of your test. So let's go through those first. We'll start with planning and the learning environment. You'll see planning for diverse learners, creating the learning environment, and classroom management. So basically, it includes everything you need to have in place before students walk into your classroom. But first, let's look at some topics you're most likely to see here in category 2, starting with lesson planning for diverse learners. The most important concepts in planning for diverse learners are individualized education programs, or IEPs, and how best to create lessons in which all members of a diverse classroom can meaningfully participate. Now, I bet you're like, okay, Emma, sounds like a lot. I know, I've got you. Starting with the IEP, you're gonna need to know what it is, what it can and cannot have in it, and who qualifies for one. So for example, you'll need to know that both modifications and accommodations may be appropriate to include in an IEP. But while many people use those two words interchangeably, they're actually two separate things. Modifications to the curriculum change what the child is taught, while accommodations change how it is taught. So for a middle school student who has an intellectual disability, it would be appropriate to modify the number of body systems they'll learn this year from 13 to 5. But a middle school student who has dyslexia is fully capable of learning all 13 body systems. Instead, their teacher may use an accommodation of less questions on a page. See the difference? A student may need modifications, accommodations, or both. That's what the IEP is for. Okay, sidebar. This isn't on the test or anything, but it seems like they missed an opportunity here. Instead of IEP, they could have rearranged it to be Programs for Individualized Education, or PI. Better, right? Back to planning for diverse learners. Teachers are responsible for planning lessons that all of their students can take part in. This could be making sure that a visually impaired student has a braille or audio version of a required reading, or that a student with cognitive delays is given a word bank. Basically, make sure that you have a plan in place to help every student experience success throughout your lesson. Next up is creating the learning environment. That sounds so magical. Creating the learning environment. But this really boils down to making sure your classroom is set up in a way that all students can use it. Let me show you a quick example of how we teach this in our study guide.
Facilitating opportunities for students with disabilities to work with typically developing peers creates chances for natural interactions that promote incidental learning about social behaviors. There are also important considerations to make when designing the physical layout of your classroom. These questions can be your guide. Are all students able to access what they need in the space? Do all students have a clear view of what or who they need to see? Can the teacher see and easily reach all students?
The biggest thing is being able to recognize your students' unique needs and creating an environment that supports them. And last but not least in category 2, classroom management. Wow, classroom management questions show up on the test a lot. And just like the rest of category 2, it's all about getting each student what they need. This can be a little tricky because first you need to know about general classroom management. But then you also need to think about how that approach might not work for students with special needs. And finally, you'll need to be able to create individualized behavior management plans for specific students. For example, it may be part of your classroom management plan that no student may walk around the classroom while you're teaching a lesson. Seems reasonable, right? Well, what this part of the test is asking you to realize is that your general plan has been made assuming your students have no cognitive or physical impairments. It may be age appropriate to block out time, say 15 or 20 minutes, where walking around the classroom is not allowed. But for some students, this might not work. For example, a student with ADHD may struggle to concentrate while sitting still for long periods of time. So it may be appropriate to give that student a job, like passing out needed supplies that allows them to walk around the classroom while you're talking. We're almost done with our first category, and then we'll go on to our next biggest chunk of the test. Let's take a look at how the Praxis will test you on actually creating individualized behavior management. In this part of the test, you'll likely see specific scenarios. You may be given a student and a problem they're having in school, and then you'll be asked about the best plan to support them. The biggest thing here is to look for the solution that addresses the problem for the individual student with minimal disruption to the rest of the class. Answer choices that include creating a behavior plan and holding the student accountable with targeted check-ins are usually all great choices. We made it through our first category. We're just getting warmed up. Let's move on to the other biggest chunk of the test, category 3. Category 3 is all about instruction, as in the actual teaching you'll be doing in the classroom. In this category, you'll need to know a variety of strategies for teaching diverse learners and how to incorporate supplemental resources to support students. One tricky thing to remember with this category is it assumes a perfect world, meaning unlimited time, unlimited money, and unlimited resources. A place where mozzarella sticks are good for you and the check engine light never comes on in your car. Unrealistic, I know, but like I said, perfect world, so keep that in mind. Let's jump in with the strategies. You're gonna need to know some basics on providing instruction for students with a variety of disabilities. So you're going to see questions where you're given a lesson and a student with a specific disability. Your job is to choose how to best accommodate that student's needs. For example, if a student has a hearing impairment, make sure instructions are only given when the teacher is facing the students so that the student can also read the teacher's lips. The key here is to know the basics, but to also understand that each student is unique and all of the given information needs to be considered. Don't worry, we're gonna look at some of these examples in a little bit, so stick around. That brings us to the supplemental resources portion. Remember when I said that bit about unlimited resources? This is where you really need to keep that in mind. Not the mozzarella sticks part, but the assistive tech part. There's some seriously cool AT out there. And on this test, you have an open cart. You're gonna see some options like providing students with fine motor deficits with speech-to-text tech so they can just speak instead of write, or screen magnifiers for students with visual impairments. Even accessible PE equipment. I'm telling you, the possibilities are endless. All right, so we've covered the two biggest, baddest, hairiest categories, meaning we've already covered the material that will make up almost half your test. Let's keep cruising through the final three. We'll head back up to category 1, development and characteristics of learners. It could be broken up into three smaller chunks: human development, developmental disabilities and delays, and impact of disabilities. Wow. Even after we broke that into chunks, it's still a lot. So let's take a look at some of the stuff that's most likely to come up. The questions about human development will focus on general, well, human development. What are developmental milestones? What are markers of healthy development? There are 4 key domains to know: physical, social, cognitive, and emotional. For developmental disabilities and delays, you'll need to know all 13 categories of disabilities that are identified by the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. I know that sounds like a lot, and it is, but you've got this. And if you need help, check out the 240 Study Guide. We've got them all outlined and organized for you. Now, moving on to the Impact of Disabilities section. This is basically an understanding of the wider impact of a student's disability on their life. Instead of just what it means for their school day, we're talking about how it impacts their home life, how it impacts their future ability to live on their own, and how to have a job. Basically, any way a student's disability could impact their life outside of school. This may sound like a recurring theme, but the most important thing to remember when answering questions about this is to find the choice that supports the student's individual needs within the scenario. Is the question asking about a student living independently? They'll need to know about meal planning and preparation, along with budgeting and paying bills. Is the student starting a new job in the scenario? On-site training with their new supervisor and assurance that they know how to get to and from work safely both align with this life situation. We're getting closer. 2 more categories. Let's move on to assessment, which can be broken down into what types of assessments exist and how to use the results of assessment. So yeah, you're taking an assessment on assessment. Feels a little meta, doesn't it? Let's get into types of assessment first. Now, you will see some special education specific assessment terms on your exam, such as the Vineland Adaptive Behavior Scales and the Woodcock-Johnson Psychoeducational Battery. but you will also have questions over general assessment terms. Expect to see vocabulary like curriculum-based, standardized, norm-referenced, criterion-referenced, summative, and formative on your exam. You'll need to be familiar with the characteristics of each type of assessment, as well as what they're typically used for in the classroom. In the using assessment results portion, you'll need to determine next steps for students based on their assessment results. One type of question that comes up a lot requires choosing the best goal or objective for a student based on assessments of their knowledge and skills. To approach this type of question, think about the student's disability, along with the specific need they have or task they're trying to accomplish. For example, an appropriate objective for a student with a specific learning disability in reading with an assessed weakness in comprehension would be to identify the problem and solution of a grade-level fiction text 4 out of 5 times. This objective aligns with the student's disability and specific area of need. This formula should help you answer this type of question. But again, to really have the confidence you deserve, go subscribe to a 240 study guide. 4 down, just 1 to go. Category 5, Foundations and Responsibilities, makes up about 20% of the questions on your test. Now, fair warning, this one is kind of a snooze fest. It's all that fun legal jargon. Because you know, everyone who sets out to be a teacher is in it for all that hot legal code action, right? What, that's not your thing? Well, we can power through it anyway. While there's a lot of content in this category, it can really be broken down into 2 sections. Laws, and the roles and responsibilities of everyone involved in the special education student's learning. Within laws, let's talk about the rights. Make sure you know your SPED rights, like IDEA. Student rights, like the First Amendment giving them freedom of speech. And family rights, such as FERPA, to protect information. But wait, there's more. If these terms all look like Greek to you, you're gonna wanna look them up. Or just use the 240 study guide. Next, your responsibilities. This has a ton of stuff about whose job it is to do what. Who writes the IEP? Who has to agree to the IEP? Who has to make sure the IEP is actually put into practice, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Basically, making sure that everyone knows their job so the student has the best chance to be successful. And there are a lot of people to know. Teachers, paraprofessionals, specialists, and of course, parents. And that's it. That's everything you'll see on your exam. And if you don't understand each of these concepts, because you need to, use the 240 study guide. It'll save you a lot of time, a lot of money, and a lot of worry. Now that we've gone over the big concepts in our 5 categories, let's look at some practice questions to show you how these concepts can appear on the test. If you want a lot of practice questions, you can click the free practice test in the description. At the end, you get a score report on how well you did on the test. Did I mention the 240 study guide has a money-back guarantee that you'll pass? Now for questions. Let's start back with those 2 biggest categories, planning and the learning environment. Here's an example from the planning for diverse learners section. Remember when I said you'd need to know the difference between accommodations and modifications? This is a prime example. The student in the question is given both extra time to complete her test and additional white space on each page. Remember that modifications to the curriculum change what the child is taught, while accommodations change how it is taught. Since neither of these changes to the test impact what the student is taught, only how they interact with the material, these are both accommodations, so this is the correct choice. While modifications versus accommodations is important, there's so much more to this section. Luckily, the study guide has it all for you. Next up, creating the learning environment. Here's a great example about a student with vision loss. Now pay close attention because several of these answers could be appropriate, but one is definitely best. This choice might seem like a smart choice because collaboration between students is often a great idea. But in this case, it reduces Austin's independence and may be distracting to other students. This one isn't appropriate since Austin's vision loss is mild. This choice might also be appropriate. However, providing a tablet may be distracting, and this may cause unnecessary attention to Austin when an easier method is available. So this is the best choice. Moving Austin to the front of the room may be sufficient. If he still has difficulty reading, the teacher can enlarge the font size for all so that it's easier to read, or choose one of the other options listed. But starting with this choice gives Austin support while bringing minimal unnecessary attention from the rest of the class. Nice! Let's tackle that other biggest chunk, category 3, instruction. Starting with a question on strategies. In this example, you're given information on a student with ADHD, a known deficit, and a goal. The use of checklists will help the student to identify a sequential process to complete assignments and remain focused on each individual portion. So this choice is best. One more in category 3, supplemental resources. In order to answer this question, you'll need to first know what each of the listed disorders or delays look like in students. Students with dysgraphia struggle with written expression and mechanics. Providing assistive technology, such as a speech-to-text program, allows students to share responses verbally, which are then recorded as text. So this is the best choice. Like I mentioned before, there's a ton of assistive tech out there. In order to learn about all of the possible disorders and tech supports you could see on your test, make sure you subscribe to the 240 Study Guide. Two categories down, three to go. Let's keep moving. Next up, category 1, development and characteristics of learners. Ooh, here's a good one on human development. The best answer here is this one. A child with developmental delays is socially delayed because he struggles to relate to peers. This is often true, as children with developmental delays will have interests different than typical peers. The last part of this section deals with the impact of disabilities. Again, you'll really need to know the specifics of common disabilities and how they can impact a student's life. In this example, we're looking at a student with an emotional disability. Emotional disability is characterized by an inability to maintain personal relationships, inappropriate types of behavior, or a generally unhappy mood. So this choice is best. A student with an emotional disability may have difficulty identifying or utilizing coping strategies. Let's see one more from the assessment category. This question asks about an appropriate way to assess a student who is visually impaired on the human skeletal system. The assessment requires that students label 20 bones on a diagram of a skeleton. The best assessment accommodation listed here is this one. Providing the student with a 3D skeleton for labeling allows them to perform the same task tactically. These choices do not align with the objective. One more category, we can do it. And it's category 5, foundations and professional responsibilities. I know these laws can be confusing. There are a lot of them, and they all have their own acronyms to remember. Sometimes I feel like I'm talking about education, and sometimes it feels like I'm just reading from a bowl of alphabet soup. But you really do have to know this stuff. If you're struggling, remember, we break all the acronyms down in our study guide. You can quiz yourself using our flashcards and get used to reading and using them in our practice problems. The last part of category 5 is that part covering the roles and responsibilities. This last question asks about the responsibilities of a parent or guardian that wishes to file a due process complaint. While all of these choices are options for the parent or guardian, the only one that is required in order to file a due process complaint is this one. When the parent files a due process complaint, he or she must include information related to identification, evaluation, and provision of FAPE, as well as any potential IDEA violations. And that's it, you made it. Are you ready for one final rainbow hands? Here we go. Congratulations on finishing the video. If you found it helpful, throw us a like. There's still plenty more to learn. Did you know that thousands of teachers have used 240 to help them pass this exam? If you really want to make sure you're prepared for the Praxis Special Education Core Knowledge Exam, take the next step and subscribe to the 240 Study Guide. It has hours of videos, so you can watch or listen while doing chores. It's test aligned, so you know precisely what you need to study. And it has hundreds of practice questions, so you can be sure you're ready. And it has the money-back guarantee. So click the link below right now to get started.